lives that they live here in India and all around the world. So we're looking at how modern Indian society is adapting to environmental changes, economic changes, social and demographic changes. And as you open your eyes and start to look around you more and more, you're going to start seeing those changes for yourself and seeing that diversity for yourself. And that's what COP is all about.
So it's kind of just good to, I mean, there is this progression in the eighth grade that we go through from we're part of a larger something, and that larger something is advisory, and we're part of a larger something, and that's the whole eighth grade, and we went on WOW, right? And that was kind of what we were thinking about, and did other things, and then AES with the hidden circles, right? This is a larger group, and now we're thinking of ourselves in Delhi and in India, right? So like we're part of this place. Whether you are from here or not, you are part of the population of Delhi. If they come around in 2021, they will ask, they'll take census. And when I was here in 2011, they came to our door and I was in the census, you know? I'm not counting the 2011 census because they came to my door and we filled out the card. So we're all part of this larger something. So that's kind of where we're going now is we're kind of stepping back to India, Delhi, all that. Does that make sense? Cool. Okay.
So POP is an effort to understand these big ideas, diversity, change, connections, initiatives, challenges in modern India. And we use the word effort because it's not meant to be easy. It's meant to be something that you work at. You work to understand. Real learning is never easy. The more you work at it, the more you get out of it. The more you'll come to appreciate your new home here in India. You will also come to see the whole world in a different way, not just here.
So sometimes the fine print matters, and these are our essential questions. We spent a lot of time in eighth grade advisory, and eighth grade teachers have spent a lot of time over the years kind of working on these. And the big ideas on the essential questions, you can read them yourselves, but the big idea here, the first one is that this is a diverse and dynamic place, that we live in a place that's full of diverse, which means lots of different kinds, dynamic, which means it's moving, right? Cultural beliefs, and we look at cultural beliefs and we look at how they influence and adapt to environmental, economic, social, and demographic changes. So it's about diversity and change. That's the first one, right? And the second one is, the second big idea is that we want to have you look at this through a variety of different lenses, right? That means that we want you to look at it through different, you know, humanities is one kind of lens. You can do a research project. That's one sort of way of looking at it. But you also look at it through art. You'll also go out and you'll interview people or talk to people in different ways. And so it's an interdisciplinary project. You'll be spending time in math class thinking about data that has to do with POP, right? So the idea here is that we're looking at this big set of things in lots of different ways. Making sense? Okay.
You're going to start to recognize on the next couple of slides some photos from your neighborhood walks. So we are incorporating these. This is your experience, and I hope that you enjoy seeing them again. So when you look at these pictures, you might not realize how important this is, but it's representing one of the single most important challenges to Delhi and to India today, which is, anyone want to guess? Water and water scarcity in particular. Falling water tables are a problem for farmers all over North India. How are they going to irrigate, how are they going to water their crops? And even though the current Delhi government has made great strides in extending access to piped water, as recently as 2013, still 13% of people living here in New Delhi don't have access to running water in their homes. On my walk home, I pass the Vivekananda camp right by my school here, and they get water delivered twice a day. They see everyone coming out with their buckets and their hoses, kids running, parents coming out, everyone is involved in getting water from a water truck like this one. Delhi also is better off than other cities in India, better rates than Calcutta, than Mumbai, than Chennai, and most Indian villages as well. People without running water
wells, right, like this. It's just a fact that there are Doug's making a lot of progress. They're laying down a lot of pipes. This is something you might decide to research because it's really interesting. In the last 5-6 years, the government has really put a lot of effort to connecting up more people with running water, and that's happened. They built more toilets in public places as well. But it's still true that millions of people have to wait in line to get water every day. And it's also true that in the developing world in general, people use an average of like only 10 liters of water per person per day. In the U.S., we use something like 400 liters of water. Now, New Delhi is much better. I think when we the statistics that we looked at in, a couple years ago, we converted it into Olympic-style swimming pools, and New Delhi uses 1,527 of those every day, which is kind of a lot of water. It's not enough to meet the government's goal. The government's goal is 172 liters per person per day. That's what we would like to have. That's the Indian government's kind of goal here in Delhi. We're not meeting that. And this is something that you might think about because we tend to use more than that. A couple years ago, some kids did this investigation where they talked to the people in the water plant at AES, and they looked at how much water ADS consumes. Yep.
I'm just thinking 172 liter a day. Does that include the same water that is needed for your clothes or washing? Does it seem so much?
Well, you don't drink it. Yeah, most of the water we bathe in it. We wash our clothes in it. Any kind of water we use around the house. People use it in the US, it's 400. The goal in India is 172. That means you get to take a bath, you get to wash your clothes, you get to cook your food. That's kind of what it adds up to. Now, AES students collectively, according to these students, they're right around 300 liters a day just while you're at school. Where do you think that comes from? Showers, right? Maybe. Big showers. It comes from your swimming pool there. It's a lot of water in the swimming pool, right? So we use a lot. That's something to kind of think about. And then we go home and use some more, right? That doesn't include your laundry. And number six.
We're back.
There we go, number six.
Okay, so in addition, India produces 4 times the amount of sewage that it can treat effectively. Sewage is what you are flushing down the toilet, right? And access to clean water is also about washing and drinking and cooking, but it's also about disease. Here in New Delhi, we dump, again, we're getting into this Olympic-sized swimming pool. Dump about 632 Olympic-sized swimming pools worth of untreated sewage, meaning it hasn't been processed, hasn't been made safer in any way. We dump that into the Yamuna River each day. Simple diseases like diarrhea, which can be caused from dirty water, can cause big problems. Even dehydration caused by diarrhea can kill young children. The good news is that access to medicine and medical care is improving and continues to save lives.
And people in India are taking a look at these issues and are initiating cool ideas to manage waste, such as this public compost project. There's all kinds of things going on. So if you want to look for an example of something that is an effort to solve some of the problems and challenges facing India, you'll find a lot of cool examples of that. Like in this park we kind of walked through last year.
And this is a neat one for a walk this year from Saraji Nagar, making it a spit and litter-free market. And although waste management is an issue in India, on average, Indians produce much less trash than Americans. And Indian waste workers, like the people working here, they collect and recycle more than half of all the plastic generated here, triple the worldwide average of about 15-20% recycling of plastic, and about 6 times the U.S. recycling rate. So what might India learn from the U.S. about waste disposal, and what might we learn from India about recycling?
Yeah, it's really tempting to think, oh, I see all this trash laying around. They must do a terrible job with recycling stuff. America's really good at very efficiently taking a lot of trash and putting it in giant holes, which you don't see. Right? They do a very good job of disposing waste in a way you don't see. But we also create a lot more waste. There are giant underground mountains of waste all over America that we're creating. Right? So it's not that India doesn't create more. It's we see more of it because in India, we don't do a very good job of disposing all the waste. But a lot of it does get recycled. If you keep your eyes open and you watch this, you will sometimes see people coming around and picking up little, you know, plastic cups that somebody's had chai out of. And they're going to put that in a bag, and they're going to take that, and it'll get recycled into plastic. So it's kind of invisible unless you're looking for it. Okay. And then I was supposed to say, as India, okay. So economic growth is really happening. We can argue about how fast it's happening and all that, but if you look around at this city, you will see people, one sign of that is you see people building big buildings, right? All the time. Walk around your neighborhood, you'll see brand new buildings and you'll see buildings going up. If I walk out of my house and take a left and take 10 steps, I'm not kidding, I can see two giant projects which they've ripped down a whole house and they're building it back up again. That's just that they're building it up to 4 stories, right? So this is happening all over. And that causes, that's some good things. There's a lot of jobs that come out of that, like construction workers, right?
And in addition to those jobs, though, it also comes at a cost. As some of those companies you might be familiar with, like Uber or Modern Bazaar or DLF, expand to meet the demand of India's growing middle class, then some small businesses, like these, are at risk of dying out. These men and women, they run the risk of losing their jobs.
So speaking of women, there are fewer women than men, especially in North India. In the state of Punjab, I think the most recent statistics we saw, there are 895 women to 1,000 men. There are many factors that cause this imbalance, including people deciding not to have girl babies and get an abortion, right? So that's one of them. And if you decide to look at that problem, you have to look at it. Look at that in a complex way. For example, it doesn't happen in the South, right? It's not a problem in most of the South. It's mostly a problem in the North. That's interesting. It's not an Indian culture problem. It's a North Indian problem. It happens more among educated people. Why is that? Well, they tend to have the money to be able to go find a doctor who will break the law and tell them if they're having a girl or a boy. Right? We don't know. But it's a complicated problem. So a lot of times students look at these problems and the only answer is more education. Well, maybe, or maybe a certain kind of education. So full of interesting, complex things. And next.
So what about school? Will that improve life in India, just like Mr. Craig was talking about? Of course education can help. During the 2012 and 2013 school year, something like 29 million Indian students were enrolled in universities. Free lunch programs and other programs to give bicycles to female students in rural areas, they really improved attendance. So not just enrolled in school, but actually showing up every day to learn. And as we saw in yesterday's presentation, India's literacy rate continues to improve. We have fewer and fewer people who just can't read. More and more people read. But by some estimates, 50 to 100 million school-aged people in India still aren't enrolled in school. They have dropped out, often to earn money or to help out with chores at home. Other children work before or after school to help money for their to help earn money for their families.
And that last statistic is one of those ones where it just reminds us, and there's a post on the new Pop blog about this. That's changing. There's a new report that just came out 3 days ago, I linked to it. It says that now 96% of rural kids are in school. 96% is way bigger than it was 10 years ago, way bigger than it was when we wrote these, when we kind of were doing this slideshow the first time. It's really changed, but a lot of them still can't read. So the quality of education is still pretty low. I'm not saying it's better in the cities, but it's still pretty low in a lot of villages. So this is all changing. Right? So if you do the POP project and you see different statistics, you say, oh no, I saw this and then I saw that, understand that sometimes it's just, if you look up 2 years later, the whole thing's gonna be different. Does that make sense? Yeah, which is fun, but it's also a challenge. So one of the things that's happening is change is that millions of Indians are moving from rural areas to cities every single year. And makes us think, what effects does it have on cities like Delhi? What is it? How does it change our city to have millions of new people coming here every year? Think for just like 10 seconds. Try to think of like three things that might change by having millions of new people coming. Put your thumb up if you got some idea of how that might change. Tell me. There's a lot packed into that. Yeah, more. What I mean, people coming do tend to do better. First generation migrants to the city aren't typically buying cars, but sometimes second generation are, right? And the population is growing, and so it does contribute to traffic and all these other things. Yeah, anything else? Anybody else? Yeah?
Supply and demand. So like, if more people are coming, there's more demand for more supplies.
What I like about this is that we're hearing this is good and bad, right? I mean, these are some migrants. You might have noticed a lot of us, I mean, everybody here in this room in a way is a migrant. Expat is really a word for rich migrant. It's, you know, temporary migrant, right? If you think about it, expat really just means that we're rich, so we don't want to call ourselves migrant laborers, right? If we were in American context, if we were Biharis and we were coming here for a day labor job, they wouldn't call us expats. Or if we were Mexicans that was, you know, coming to America to pick cotton, they don't call them expats, but they call it anyway. So just we're all kind of migrants, right? And there's all kinds of us, and we take some resources and we give some resources, right? That's what I'm hearing. Like it's good and it's yeah.
So these people moving to Delhi every day, every year. And then there's us.
Hey!
Right? Those wealthy migrants, as we're talking about, coming here to Delhi. So this is us. We're in the middle of all this. We are part of this larger something happening in Delhi, happening in India, all of these changes, all this diversity we've been talking about since yesterday. We're in the middle of it, and we are a part of it, and it becomes a part of us. So, why us? Why POP? So, I'd like you to turn and talk, like, why are we doing this project? Why is it important? And why us? Country we live in. What does that give to me? What do I get out of it? Gratitude. I really like that idea. I was also thinking of empathy. Gratitude, being grateful for things, having some empathy for the people I meet and live with and see every day. Anything else for why us? Why are we studying this? Why is it important for 8th grade at AES to study this program? Important to know where you live, know how you fit into things where you live.
You might also, guys, I'm going to tell you a secret. Some kids figure out, some kids don't, but you might also find that most of the people in this country are living pretty interesting lives. They have parents that love them. They have friends they like to play with, just like you do, right? And so I'm hopeful. In fact, some of them have really good friends and really have a good time. You know what I mean? Like, so I'm hopeful that you don't come away thinking, oh man, thank God. Maybe that's not your big takeaway. Hopefully you'll come away thinking, oh yeah, the world is full of interesting people who are living interesting lives and facing challenges. I don't know if you've been paying attention. If you're from the U.S., we have our challenges, right? We have a national emergency over immigration, but everybody's talking about migration. Well, migration is an issue here too, right? We have people dying in the U.S. because they're taking drugs, like 70,000 a year or something crazy like that in 2017. So don't think when you see these problems that India is the only country that has problems, right? And don't see when you think of the good things you see, don't think that there aren't good things in America. I mean, there are good things all over the world, right? So hopefully you come away with an idea that is, there's one other thing I just gotta say, Mr. Prince, is it. You get to do primary source research here, right? If you were studying migration in America, you would have to read about it online. If you're studying rural-urban migration here in India, you can go out there and you can do surveys, you can do primary source research. Can actually see what it looks like. As a learner, this is a really good opportunity for you. Right? I mean, this gives you access to kinds of data that you would not have if you're studying a different country. So I would say that just on that base alone, this is a pretty cool project. Whatever you're studying, you'll be able to talk to people who are involved in that issue, and that's something you can't do if you're studying something far away. Make sense?
I'm going to go to the project website,
yes.
Where this is going to be the hashtag for all the information that you could possibly need for POP. So I hope you don't mind us saying, usually we'll say, well, it's on the website. We'll also help you navigate it.
So the website, some days it looks better than others. I'm going to update it again. I sat down and tried to update it today, and I couldn't get the picture loaded up, so it's not quite as nice looking as I wanted it to be. But we're going to show you some of the things just to know about. So it's a big thing, right? I mean, one of the problems that we have as teachers when we teach POP is that it's changing all the time, right? It's not like you can order a textbook and it's all in there. You got to keep updating the links and everything. So you're going to see tons of resources on the POP website, and you'll see some posts that are informational. There's a couple different kinds of things to find here. But understand that you have to do the research because it's all changing and it's all the time, right? So just so you know, up here at the top, you're going to see there's some general information about the project you can explore. There are topic resources. If you're thinking about doing research on one of these topics, I would definitely want you to go and take a look at what we have. We have a lot of good resources up there already, right? And that'll help you get a sense of kind of, is this something I want to explore more? Does that make sense? And then you can learn about different parts of the project, but understand that this itself is a work in progress, right? And so, it means some of the stuff from a couple of years ago is going to change this year, yeah? All right, but we try to keep it updated with. And then resources are a really important one. And then if you go down a little bit, So then you're going to see, I mean, I put up some of the statistics, the new education statistics. If you're really into that sort of stuff and you want to read about it, got some stuff right there. And we'll keep updating. Next week, you have some speakers coming in. As soon as I have a final confirmation on all of them, I'll put a little bio up on them so you'll get to know about who's going to come in next week. Yeah. So this is something you should bookmark. The address is
hop.nsblogs.aes.ac.in.
And we'll send that out in the next few days to you on your Google Classroom. Okay. Okay. So the next thing is nuts and bolts. Okay, so we will be giving you updates, communicating with you about POP through Google Classroom. Okay? So that is something that you're going to have to keep your eyes on. That'll come through your advisory classroom. And either Ms. Cullen or I will typically be the one sending this stuff out. Yeah? On Monday, and I will put up the schedule. I didn't do it today. Don't know why, but I'll put the schedule up today on the POP blog, and we'll send that out. On Monday, you're going to start going from, each advisory is going to rotate through different classes, basically, different introductory sessions. Yeah? I'm going to put up the thing and show you in a little bit. I'm going to go find it. But I said, you got it? Oh, you're awesome. So what that means is my advisory will pair up typically with another advisory, and we might all go to a little introduction session on, could be urban-rural migration, or it could be gender issues, or it could be renewable energy. And the purpose of those sessions is to give you a little bit of, like teasers. Maybe this is what I'd like to get more information about. Maybe this is what I want to research.
Think of it like a buffet. And we're going to try to be selling you on our dish being the most delicious one. It's kind of like the British Bake Off. We would really like you to choose the one that we are going to be presenting on. I know Mr. Dodds and I are going to be presenting on water scarcity and water pollution and waste. I know that doesn't sound fun immediately, but it is so interesting. And I'm really excited to present it to you. And so you will rotate through all these topics, get a little taste of each, and the one that really hooks you, they're like, that's the one that seems the most delicious to me, and I want more of it, then that could be your pop topic.
Yep. And you get to choose between whether you want to do find a problem to study and look at the cause effect solutions, or whether you want to look at an initiative, like something that somebody's doing, and look at the strengths of the initiative. So, for example, maybe you want to look at solar power efforts, right? You want to look at the strengths, limitations, and the next steps. You could even look at a thing like, security is a new one. You could look at a process, like, for example, urban-rural migration, which I'll be selling you on, and that's like, that's got good, you know, good things about it, maybe things that are challenges, kind of like, alternatives. Okay, anyway. So, what I'd like you to do right now is, we'll give you this up later, we'll show you. We can just do the question. So, if you open up your iPad, you should have in your advisory thing, Ms. Cullen shared a link to your first ever reflection, and you're going to work on that. Okay, buddy, just hang on. You're going to have to say, we'll talk to you about this later, but you're going to have to do these reflections as you go through the POP. You're going to get to do it, and give you some time to think about the first 2 days of the kickoff. Yeah? Okay, here's what it looks like, guys. Watch me. So Monday, Monday, my advisory, Dodds and Craig, will start out doing gender and ring 101. Then on Tuesday, then the next time that we meet, they will go on the 23rd, on Wednesday, they'll go to this session. Can you follow me? You have to find your, if you're in my advisory, you're going like this. And here's the dance, okay? It'll be confusing the first day, and then everybody's going to be just like, I get it totally. It's a rotating thing. You get to these different sessions.
And it'll go up on the bulletin board in the hallway, too.
Okay. First reflection. Yep, first, you can start working on your first reflection. We'll have guest speakers here in a minute, so you'll add to that. But we'll give them a minute to set up, and we'll start working on this first reflection. This will be graded and it will be on your report card, and that is not a joke. I'm just letting you know, that's not a joke. I joke a lot, but that's not a joke. Yeah, this is part of your thought process. Yeah.
So,
your
teacher.
So we have asked some ninth graders, they were in your shoes a year ago, we've asked them to come back and talk to you a little bit about their projects and answer any questions that you have, and you can ask them anything. They will be truthful. We have no authority over them anymore, so they don't have the same kind of fear that you do.
I thought that was funny.
It was supposed to be a joke. They're like, no, no, we're allowed to laugh because we have that much fear. So, we're very excited to have them. We have Carrie, Anaya, Rohan, Nicholas, Vicky, and Enoch here. I'm just going to ask them to introduce themselves, even though I just did, and to just tell you what it was that you chose to study. So, your kind of general topic, and if you want, you could talk about kind of the specific research as well. Feel free to use the microphone if you talk quietly, and if you talk loudly, feel free to not use the microphone. We'll start with you, Carrie.
I'm Carrie, and my topic was child trafficking. And I guess about the research, the main thing was differentiating between child labor and child trafficking. So make sure you know what your topic is.
My name is Anaya, and my topic was human trafficking. My name is Rowan, and I did gender inequality in the literacy gap.
My name is Nicholas, and I did child labor.
I'm Vicky, and I did air pollution.
My name is Enoch, and I did air pollution, and I did about the health problems and the solutions.
Cool. All right, so, did a round of applause about it. Okay. Alright, so I have plenty of questions that I have loaded up and I can ask them, but because you, sometimes that is necessary to get started, but some of you may have some questions that you have ready to go right now. So we're happy to start with questions or I can start with a question. Does anyone have a question they feel like some I really want to know about? I'll put a caveat on it and say that you don't really need to ask them questions about scheduling, what comes first, we're gonna tell you all that stuff. I think you wanna ask them more kind of philosophical, what do you think about it? So asking more opinion type questions as opposed to when does this happen, right? Because we'll answer that and that information will be provided to you.
I have one.
Yeah.
What's your biggest advice? You did the project. I'm a new teacher and I'm gonna have to teach the project, but what's your biggest advice to the eighth graders? What does that mean?
So, being able to spread out, plan yourself to what you're going to do each week so that it doesn't come to the last 2 weeks or so and you haven't done much. And that's really tight because even with the service, if you let it to the last week, that's going to be impossible because you have to do a few hours for service too.
And make sure you know the difference between just planning what you're going to do and actually doing it. I remember there were a lot of times where I had, okay, I'm going to study it like when I get home, and then I didn't. So make sure you motivate yourself.
And also, when we research,
and I use the microphone.
start. What do you mean with organize it properly?
Well, I just had mine on Google Tools and I made note cards for each of them and that worked well for me.
Are your humanities teachers going to help with that?
Yes.
Great.
I'd say don't be scared. Like, I was, when I was starting off, like, all the 10th graders now were like, oh, it's kind of hard. You gotta, like, write this long essay and stuff. But the teacher will help you out if you're struggling, and don't be scared.
Can you repeat the question, please? I'm not sure if I heard. The question was, what was the biggest challenge you faced?
Like, not procrastinating every day. Because, like they said in time management, you don't want to procrastinate. Because with procrastination, it's kind of one of those things that you'll procrastinate today, and then tomorrow you'll say, it's not that much work, I'll do it on the weekend. The weekend you have plans, and it kind of goes on, and you don't really find time.
I agree to that, because I did 4 ACFs. I lived in Gurgaon, so I didn't have much time to waste. So I think time management is really important.
Can you talk about finding information? Was there too much? Was there not enough? Where did, like, what was the most helpful? How were you able to find information?
I think it's really important to look at your topic, because that will really depend on find information too. If you do a topic that's too narrow, it'll be really hard for you to find information that's going to make the project a lot harder. It'll be possible, but it's going to waste a lot of your time. So be able to find a topic which isn't too broad, but you can also still find information about it.
And also make sure that, the library provides great resources for you to use, and that definitely helped last year. I just found that really helpful, so you guys should too.
And you're not just completely blind. There are, like Vicky said, databases that will really narrow down your searches, so you're not just, searching Google.
Can I ask a question about just choosing a topic? About maybe how did you choose the topic that you chose? Are you happy? Like, if you could do it again, would you choose the same topic? One of the things that I think we might think about when choosing topics is, I want a topic that's easy, or I want a topic because that's what my buddy is doing, or, right? So, like, can you talk a little bit about the way you chose a topic and any advice you have around that?
You should pick a topic that you're really interested in, because if you don't like it that much, you're going to get really sick of it soon, and you need to research that topic for more than a month, so you should like it.
Well, also, really pick up the topic, pick a topic that you really like, but also, if it's extremely hard, maybe you can try to get something that's a little easier and that you also like, because you're going to be doing this for a long time.
You can always make your or whatever topic you chose more specific. Like, there's always ways to close it down almost, but I think, as Anani said, just making sure you choose one that you're going to stick with, because you spend a lot of time with it. So, what I did was I kind of had an idea what I wanted to do. Like, I want to do something with gender, but I don't know what section. So I stuck with gender and I didn't really change it. And then over the course of law, I kind of wanted to go more into the literacy gap and between men and women and the difference.
I also think it's important that you don't have very much background knowledge on the topic you choose, just because then you really get interested into it and you don't just spend your time reading over things you haven't heard about.
What was your favorite part? What was fun? Looking back, what was your favorite part?
Definitely service, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Because since I was doing child labor, I spent a lot of time with kids. And Ms. Kapoor has a group she goes to every Tuesdays and Thursdays, which, if you're doing child labor, it's really nice to reach out to her. It's a really nice group, and you spend a few hours there a few times.
so excited to go to school every day and just, you know, like seeing what education can do to them and help them, like, advance so much further.
Santino?
Yeah, you not said that you did before in India. And then looking back here, was it hard to manage your time out in India?
It was hard, but there were some deadlines during ASIAC, but I had to work in plane and then to host families' houses. So it was challenging, but you can do it.
Adding on to that, realistically, you're not going to get anything done during your actual trip. I guess we've all kind of been through that. So make sure to do it beforehand to give you the opportunity to just get it done before.
What did you say? It was the latest she stayed up?
Yeah.
All of these students manage their time perfectly.
Yeah.
You should all be in bed by 9.
Anybody got to pull a really late night? Or were you in? Yeah. I think one of the things that you'll see is the teachers over the 15 years of this project have really tried to make sure that to help you along those deadlines, right? In the end, you have to do the work, right? But if you follow the schedule that is laid out for you, you will have many of those late nights.
Yeah, last year when the high schoolers to us, they were all like, don't procrastinate, it'll just come back to bite you. And I did not listen. I was, you know, pulling late nights and everything, but now actually, listen to us because they procrastinate.
And so it's interesting because Carrie, so some of you are new and you're like, oh my gosh, but Carrie came in, this was your third day of school last year, right?
Yeah.
So if you were one of those students, you're like, oh man, this isn't fair. I just came in. Carrie was in that boat last year, so.
Yeah, and if that's you this year, it actually gave me a good opportunity to just focus on that completely, sort of an outlet. It's really hard adjusting to India and this big school. I was in a really small school, but I just sort of focused on the project. So if that's you this year, then there are some benefits.
I think the most important part is that you get to learn something new about India. I'm sure you learned something new by studying this project. And just really looking around you, because there are a lot of problems that India has, and I think it just opens your eyes up to the world a little bit, and each stage of pop really interests me.
Yeah, I'd like you all to answer that question, actually. I think it's a really good one, which is, why do you think this is an important project, or what do you think was important about it? So thank you. For the rest of the answer?
I thought it was important because it's important to learn about the country that you're living in, even if it's not your home country. When I was nearby the seats and I was to 9th graders, which are 10th graders now, they just said, this teaches you for high school, and now I finally I'll help you to kind of organize the two high schools.
Yes, I really agree with that. The searching mainly in pop really helped me. So if you're not really good at searching stuff, you're gonna have a few classes I think to really start digging into that. And then for high school, you're really gonna be more ready into finding stuff and reliable sources. So that helps.
Yeah, I felt like pop really prepared me for high school. Also, it's really good to know about the country that you live in. Talk a lot about like where you live, and if you don't know about it, it's kind of embarrassing.
Also, like most of us live in our own bubble, and we don't really see that outside perspective and the issues that India has. So, as I said, like this really just opens you up to those situations, and makes you more aware. I'd say.
Yeah, it sort of just teaches you your own, research in a more mature manner. It prepares you for high school, like everybody said. And like, I think if we hadn't done the POP project, I think all of us would sort of be drowning right now. And yeah, like everybody said, it's a good way to step outside your comfort zone and meet people who you wouldn't have really met if you got your own time.
Bills? What was the hardest month during the POP process?
Like which of the parts? So there's four parts, right? You have data analysis, research, and then investigation, and creative design. Which is the hardest part? How about that? That's probably good. Do you have a part that was the most challenging for you?
For me, it was the independent investigation. You guys talked about that. Just because it really depends on who you interview. Like I had to do one of my interviews over the phone on my floor because we have a landline. So I was on the floor with the phone like on my shoulder trying to get them as much as possible. And there was a lot of that, crazy struggling to get everything down. So that was me.
I also think the independent investigation was the hardest part because I did service for nine and you have to plan according to the organization, go at a time where you can interact with the kids or whoever. I would just say revising my essays because I feel like I'm done and then I go over and I have something to fix. Like I'll feel like I'm not totally perfect and just revising the essay just kind of came with more stress because then you feel like you're not done. But every time you revise, there's something little to fix.
To me, it was probably research. I would type up like my project and if the perfect answer didn't come, I'd be kind of stressed. So that was kind of an issue.
I think the most difficult part for me was probably the independent investigation as well. I think it's just a matter of finding the right person to interview or because they might not always speak English. So make sure you have like someone to translate it for you or have that open because that was one of the parents struggled
with. Mine was like research because my topic was air pollution. There's so much about it. Like, if you go to the Google and stuff, there's like thousands, like hundreds of thousands of information. Like picking out the right stuff and like knowing what to find and what to write about, I think that was pretty helpful.
We have time for one more. Santino?
Was it hard to find a reliable source?
Hard to find reliable sources.
If you're on one of the databases you get from the library site, it'll be really easy, but then again, finding what you want is going to be the hard part because it being reliable won't be an issue.
Okay, I want to just ask one final question, then we're going to let these kids go eat lunch. If you had to do it again, would you do it? So, like, you're in these kids' shoes, right? You get the chance to relive it. Would you still do the POP project?
I wouldn't want to, but I think with the knowledge I have now, I would think I have to do this to prepare myself.
The other part of that might be like, is it worth it? Like,
yeah, definitely, it's worth it.
Yeah, when you said that.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to do it again because it was a lot of work. But I think it was definitely
honest, I would really like to go to the whole process again, but like the result is what matters, so I would do it again. You know, if I was in your shoes.
Yeah, I wouldn't do it again, but if I hadn't done it, which I've already done it last year, I would do it because it would be terrible.
I'd do it again. I mean, like, as long as I chose a different topic, I think. Like another one that would interest me, I think I'd do it. But the process, as long as you like just stay with it, you can do it pretty well.
Yeah, pop was definitely worth it. It like helps you prepare for high school and helps you learn how to manage your time well and just, like learning about new things.
Thank you so much. Can you give me a huge round? Sense of rule, and we will need them, and it is a requirement, like it's part of the class. And I want you to be motivated to do this because you're motivated to learn. I really do. But in full disclosure, this is on the report card. It doesn't mean that it's the most important part of your pop grade is this reflection here, but it is the first reflection that I'm going to read when I sit down and look at it. And so it probably is kind of important. Might as well start off in a good way, right? And it'll also kind of start you off in a way, take it seriously. So please, we keep the reflections minimal. We cut a lot of them out. We try to really reduce that so that we only ask you to reflect on things that are meaningful. Yeah? And so that's our commitment to you, and then we ask you to be thoughtful. On Monday, I will put that flyer up on the POP blog, and I will share that with you by the end of the day. Well, if and I'm on a bulletin board. What's that? And on the board, the student board. Yeah, it'll be on the student board. If I'm on your, I don't know, okay, I'll try to get those shared by the end of the day because I'm not sure. All you teachers, I have to be co-teaching all you. I think I am. I'll check. Maureen's not here. Okay, Monday, look for where you go and be ready to take notes on your advisory lesson. Okay, so bring paper and pencil.